This is firefighter Raphael Porriette for Firehouse Subs. Introducing new Firehouse Pairs. Pair your favorite small sub with a signature side, like the awesome 5-Cheese Mac and Cheese. And remember, a portion of every purchase at Firehouse Subs goes towards helping first responders. Firehouse Subs. Enjoy more subs. Save more lives. Participating locations only. Firehouse Subs would donate a minimum of $1 million in 2019 to the Firehouse Subs Public Safety Foundation by donating 0.11% of every purchase.
Hello, Wildcats. It's your boy, Kev, coming at you with a quick disclaimer here before we start, letting you know that we are a comedy and crime podcast. So even though we do cover many serious cases and true events, we do like to throw in some inappropriate jokes and dark humor every now and then. And especially on this episode, a little bonus disclaimer, things do get a little shiesty and out of hand, and if you are easily offended, we definitely push the limits on some of the jokes in this one. So just a heads up. And also a special shout out and a very big thank you to our Bash Brothers in The Last Bandoleros. They recorded us an outro song, and it was just a little like jam session they had that is just rad as fuck. It's super awesome. And they're allowing us to use it for our closing tune. So that's super cool, and you should all stick by and give it a listen. And alrighty, thank you everyone for listening. Be good, stay safe, and laugh at the dark stuff. Hashtag Wildman.
All right, fellas, like we practiced.
Yeah.
2, 3, 4.
Come on down. Come on down. Hanging with the brothers tonight, yeah. Come on down to the Brothers Commonplace tonight.
All righty. Welcome, everyone, to the Brothers Commonplace, a comedy and crime podcast where we cover monsters, murders, mysteries, and more. And today we got a super spicy topic from your favorite spicy boys. Here we go.
Okay.
What's going on, guys? This is Tim. And I have to put in my shameless plug here. I just got done recording my Christmas album. So that'll be hitting stores here soon. It's called All I Want for Christmas is Toof. So take a look at that. You'll find it at your Dollar General or maybe even Dollar Tree. But yeah, take a look at that. It's pretty good.
Yeah, when I was dumpster diving at the Salvation Army, I found like 50 copies.
Dude, one time when I was actually in the band and we recorded a little album thingy, we gave them out to a bunch of people we worked with. And one of those people was neighbors with my girlfriend's parents.
Yeah.
And so my girlfriend's dad was like, yeah, I saw your album for sale at a garage sale.
Oh, my God. Yes.
Fuck yeah.
And they all fucking laughed at me.
Oh, my God.
That's awesome.
Hey, what up, everybody? This is Spence. You know, life for me has been pretty difficult since I was turned into a horse. But my wife and I, we've been getting by. We've continued our family trade. Now she just rides on me when we go to rob banks.
Oh, yes.
We're called Bonnie and Clydesdale.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. I love that.
Old Mr. Hands over here. Hey, everybody, it's Toof. And little known fact, I like to sing about my my recent Tinder dates. So let's just say this this girl had like a 1-star face if she was a podcast. So I walked in the restaurant and I saw her and I was like, dude, this chick is, oh man, I don't know if this is a fucking gargoyle statue or a real girl. So, oh yeah, I forgot the singing part. Then I saw her face. Now I'm a leaver. She's so ugly. I had to say goodbye. And to all the female podcast listeners, most of you, all of you are beautiful. So, not to direct that toward women in general.
He started with most.
So you just left her right at the restaurant. I was wondering why my mom was so pissed off at you two.
It's all right. I gave her a ride home, if you know what I mean.
She always comes crawling back to you, Tim.
That's right. I had beer goggles that night, so it was okay.
There's nothing better than leaving her at Red Lobster, because if she's all wet and moist, you couldn't smell it anyway with all the seafood around.
Jesus.
And it's your boy Kev, a.k.a. the Dirty Dog. And if God hears everything, then that means he's most certainly listening to the Brothers Commonplace podcast. And so I do have one request, God, and that is, could you please just fucking quit killing members of the band LFO? There's only one left, you son of a bitch. Let him fucking live, man.
It's actually like a nice thought, though, that God listens to everything, because if he listens to everything, now we have 5 listeners. So that's good.
Yeah, it would be 6, but since Andrew quit listening.
Say what? So he still hasn't heard Andrew talk yet?
So, alrighty, it's time to enter the month of December with your favorite boys, your favorite sexy boys. And what better way than to discuss a murder case that recently happened in our own home state?
Oh, shit.
That's right. Today, we're going to discuss the 73-year-old dipshit by the name of Philip Snider. But before we get any further into talking about this fucking geezer, let's talk about the city that it all takes place in, the wonderful place known as Canton, Ohio.
A.K.A. Sexopolis.
Philip Snider to me sounds like, come on down to Philip Snider Chevrolet.
It really does.
Like, that's all I can think of. But this fucking dude is just an old piece of shit.
Like, I was trying to think of a Rob Schneider joke, but that's not even funny. It just rhymes.
Unless this guy committed some burglaries. Or we robbed him.
Oh, fuck yeah.
Rob Schneider?
Yeah.
Rob Schneider. We robbed this guy.
I'm nervous as fuck. My girlfriend's dad's side of the family, they got me a Santa suit. So even though Santa is real, they want me to dress up as Santa.
Mm-hmm.
And it's probably a 4-year-old and like a 2-year-old maybe. And they want me to like show up at their Christmas and, but like, I don't know what to say. Like, what if they start questioning me? Like, what if they say, like, you're not the real one? What am I supposed to do? Like, ho, 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 gotta leave now. Like, I'm scared to, like, I don't know what to even say. Do I hand out gifts and be like, there's many kids I must stop to go to and just like leave?
I mean, I kind of like that.
At least the beard's real.
I'm not, my demands were I'm not spray painting the beard. Right. So that I have to get a fake one.
Yeah, you would definitely have to get a fake
one. But I'm scared to death. Like, what if I start getting interrogated by a 5-year-old who's got more questions than I have answers?
Just be like, shut up, dipshit.
Yeah, I was say I would sweet chin music, man. Like, that's, you know, that's never done wrong.
Would you like me to bring your favorite pet back to life? Shut your mouth.
Just if they start questioning
or I'll
you,
kill it again.
If they start questioning you, just be like, you know what, you get this, and pull out a Creed CD. Because unless it's my dad, holy, they're probably going to be pissed off.
And his name was Creed Bratton.
All right, so here we go. Canton, Ohio, the birthplace of professional football. American, that is, not El Football. The very first professional team being the Canton Bulldogs.
I did not know that.
And which brings us to the next good thing about Canton. It is home to the Pro Football Hall of Fame, which is super badass. But that's not all. There's also the William McKinley Presidential Library and Museum, and also the National First Ladies Library.
Wow, that's cool. When I was looking for houses in Wellington, one of them was the campaigning headquarters of William McKinley.
Hmm.
It's a dirtball house. Huge, but dirtball. It's like built in like 1856.
That's right.
So I might as well make the joke that everyone made my last name at this place. Oh, can't-in? More like cannot. Fuck that joke.
A little laugh afterward.
So all that's pretty exciting and badass, but we aren't done yet. How about music? Bam, Reliant K, Marilyn Manson, Macy fucking Gray, all from Canton.
I know you want to
save the worst for last. Good job, bud.
I know you want to do it, Kev.
Nah, dude, I've already done it for an intro.
Yeah. Does it just stop there?
Dude, oh, this one dude I was working with is this old dude, like 50-something-year-old, but he's this real hillbilly redneck guy. And sometimes he asks me questions, I just have to be like, nah, dude, I don't know what you're talking about, just so I don't open that fucking can of worms and have to have a conversation with him. But one day at work, he was like moving all like fast and crazy, like working super hard. And then he looks over, he's like, man, you ever listen to Marilyn Manson?
Oh.
Gets me real pumped up to work. I was like, nah, dude, never heard of him. Because I was like, I don't want to fucking talk to this guy about that.
I mean, nobody wants to talk about Marilyn Manson anyway.
You know where he was trying to bring that topic. You ever, you know, I'm just spitballing here, but you ever had think about having one of your ribs removed, maybe? Have you heard of that story?
Oh, fuck yeah, dude. I had one of my, never mind. I was saying I had one of my ribs removed so I could suck his dick.
Even though this makes no sense in the anatomy or whatever, but like I had one of my ribs removed, but it was one of the back ones, so I just bent backwards and licked my ass.
So, alrighty, anything before we move on to the case? Alrighty, here we go. And there's lots of quotes in this one today, and a lot of them were pulled from commercialappeal.com.
Nice.
So let's enter our main characters in this story. Philip Snider and his wife, Roberta Bobby Snider, from Hartville, Ohio.
Philip Snider and his wife?
Yes, his wife, Roberta.
Oh, shit. So was their son the water boy?
Roberto. Was it Roberto?
Yeah.
Is that the dad?
Yeah.
Helen. Who's Helen?
That's my first name, Bobby.
Oh, hey, Bobby. Seen you on the ESPN.
Dude, I hadn't seen that movie in a while. Like, I always kind of liked it. I watched it recently. That movie's funny as fuck.
It's fucking good.
Yeah,
dude.
I forgot it was that good.
Then Hartville is located right dab in the middle of Akron and Canton. And one thing to know about the Sniders, they have been married for 53 years. Philip being 73 years old and his wife Roberta being 70 years old. So they're fucking old as shit.
Yeah.
So these fucking antiques, they went on the road. Never mind. I was just trying to weasel my way into an antiques road show
joke. Yeah.
More like antiques freak show.
Oh.
Have you seen their ugly asses?
Oh, come on. Not Roberta, dude.
Oh, okay, something bad happens.
Philip is ugly as fucking sin, though.
Fuck off, Philip.
I know, that's how you know something bad happens to him, when I instantly start defending him and you have no idea why.
I heard the guy got Botox recently.
Yeah.
Philip, right?
Philip. Oh, shit. And Philip, he is a retired union carpenter who crafted cigar box ukuleles at his home.
Wait, what?
Yeah.
All right.
So that's pretty cool.
Wait, ukulele? Oh, the little guitar. Mm-hmm. I thought it was like a harmonica. Like, he just like takes a cigar box.
I have a cigar box. Huh. I know what this needs to be.
And for the Benton County Police, including Sheriff Kenny Christopher, this case first came to their attention on January 9th, 2018. So just at the beginning of the year is when this all happened.
Damn.
Just, this is stupid. What? So, speaking about harmonicas, like, you know, like the clitoris is a myth, the female orgasm is a myth.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Something is real. If you, if you're ever down on your lady and you happen to blow in there on accident, it's like a harmonica. I didn't know this. And I was like, and it's just like playing all these sounds. I kept waving my head back and forth.
It really is. Last time I was going down on a chick and I did that, I fucking just wound up in a completely another world.
Dude, I remember.
It's just a Mario joke.
Oh my God. Dude. Kevin, the last time we lived together and you went down on a chick, I thought you were playing the fucking Blues Travelers in the next room.
Dude, going down and check is a lot of work, man. Sometimes you'd be like, fuck, dude, I had to have been down here like 45 minutes. It's been like 2.5 minutes. You're like, I don't even need to finish. I'm done. I'm just going to go to bed.
I always used to tell my buddies, like, it's working on the docks. Like, yeah, you might see some water, but all it does is just smell like fish. Continue on.
And so the way that the police came about this case in the beginning of January was that sometime during the beginning of January, Roberta would disappear. But how did the police find out so quickly that Roberta was missing? Well, here's a quote. Mrs. Snider, she was a big Elvis fan, and she wanted to see Graceland before she died. So her husband, he was trying to fulfill her wishes. Her doctor said that he didn't think she was in good enough shape to survive an 11.5-hour trip each way. And according to the police, the Sniders, since they were such big fans of Elvis, they decided they had to leave right away and go to Graceland to visit. And who knows, maybe while they were there, they could even catch a glimpse of the real king himself. That is, if you believe that Elvis isn't really dead.
Is Graceland in Tennessee?
Yes.
That's 11 hours from here?
Yeah. But the thing is, if they like really, really wanted to go visit the king, they didn't have to go all the way to Tennessee. For the real king was just a short distance away all along.
Yeah, he wasn't
up
far.
Up north in Akron, Ohio. King, our Lord and Savior, LeBron James.
That's right.
All hail he who is holy.
There comes a time when a decision must be made. Will the king move on or will he stay? We're helplessly waiting as we hold. Should we renew our tickets for next year? Please say, LeBron, we really need you. No bigger heart is gonna love you half as much as we do.
It's a choice you're making.
So the Sniders, they headed out of Hartville on January 4th to make the 725-mile trip to Graceland. Here's another quote from Sheriff Christopher. The police chief in Hartville contacted me and said they were getting a lot of conflicting stories from Mr. Snider. And Sheriff Christopher said, the police chief in Hartville contacted me and said they were getting a lot of conflicting stories from Mr. Snider, but myself and my investigators have been able to confirm that he did stay at the Days Inn in Memphis, and he did stay at the Days Inn here in Benton County at exit 126. And then this is where things start to get a little weird.
I thought they stayed at the Holiday Inn.
Go who you yes. with. I always liked the edited version of that song. Where I mean, no one liked it, but where Ludacris's part comes in,
yeah.
where he's like, stop, drop, kaboom, baby, rub on your nipples.
Yeah.
But on the fucking edited, he's like, stop, drop, kaboom, baby, rub on your back.
Oh, he does.
So call me Ludacris. And that doesn't even fucking rhyme.
Oh, my yeah. God.
Yeah.
Awesome. Is that Chingy?
Wait, you can't fucking say nipples? Why can't you say nipples?
I don't know.
It was like, that was like 2003 or 4. Like, you're allowed to like...
Yeah.
You're allowed to say...
You can say the N-word.
You can say...
Well, my dad could say it anyways growing up. He said it a lot to me. And the dog.
Well, I mean, he was hooking up with a lot of Puerto Rican chicks at the time.
So we do know that Roberta somehow vanished, but we don't know how she vanished. And according to Philip Snider, he said that his wife Roberta passed away during the trip. However, our boy Phil, he likes to change his story up constantly. And the cause of her death, according to Philip, was of natural causes. And the one case that I read about said that she choked on phlegm and then died because of that. And in another story, he said she died from cancer on their trip.
Let's say you're a magician. Let's just say you're David Copperfield.
Yeah.
And like Roberta, he said she went missing or disappeared.
We'll get to it more what happened, but Philip, he comes back from his trip without her.
What if like he was performing an act on stage? Like he actually already killed her, but he performed an act on stage and she disappeared, and like he tried to make her reappear and he's like, wait a minute. Like he started searching like the cabinet that she disappeared in, and he's like, folks, this is really real. She actually disappeared. Do the cops even have a could they even arrest him then?
Well, not those police. They would have to obviously get the magic police.
Yeah. Have fun.
Chris Angel.
Yeah. Have fun. Have fun calling Chris Angel. He's on vacation at Hogwarts right now.
He's not on vacation. He's teaching there now. He's a new Defense Against the Dark Arts teacher.
Him with Snape's hair.
So pretty much his hair.
And here's another quote from Sheriff Christopher. First, her husband said she passed away in Kentucky. And I think since then he has changed his story saying that she passed away. And then he flagged down an ambulance. And the ambulance people checked her and said, yes, she is dead. And then they let him drive off with her.
Yeah, that's what happens.
Then he changed his story and said that he flagged an ambulance down and they checked her and put her in an ambulance and left with her. And now he has no idea where she is, like what they did with her body.
Both of those are believable.
So both of those things that just don't happen. Like, there's no way. They're like, yeah, she's dead. Yeah. Just take her.
They're like, she's dead. You mind if we take this and make a lamp out of it?
It's for this movie Christmas Story.
You mind if we take this? We're making a remake of RoboCop.
We're filming the Lion King movie that's coming out. We're filming that. And to make it real, we're just going to throw our fucking dead-ass body to some lions and film that for an hour.
Either that or we're going to use her as chum for making Jaws 5.
So when he flagged down the ambulance, they're like, is your wife okay? They're like, he's like, yeah, she's just a little under the weather. She's not feeling good. I don't know. And they like grabbed her and took off. And he's like, oh, shit, it was the Undertaker.
Because he takes the unders.
They took her. Never mind.
Oh, yeah.
I would say they were actually filming that Tarantino movie with Kurt Russell. And they took her as a fucking
Please keep going.
Every fucking stunt that involved him running her down, they just chucked her in front of the car.
That's not funny.
So I don't know how many of these are staying in and which ones are, but we're super fucking sorry.
No, we're not.
She was old as fuck. Like, you could have just waited a little bit.
He must not have had a week and a half, man.
All right, where were we? So, yeah, so that's what he says. He keeps changing up his story constantly, saying different things happen. And I know this fucking knuckle dragger is old, but I'm pretty sure he would remember, like, how his wife died, and he wouldn't keep changing the story up. And of the stories that stuck out the most, it was when Philip told the Ohio police officers that after his wife died, he dumped her body off a bridge and into the Tennessee River. And Sheriff Christopher, he says, his story to them now is that he stayed in Memphis and went to Graceland and had her in the back of his truck after she died. And then he spent the night there with her in the back of his truck. The next day, he came back to Benton County and stayed at the Days Inn. We have confirmed that the video showed him to be alone when he was there, so she was still in the truck, if that story is true.
You know, I'm probably, where there's probably going to be more details coming out about this, but I can almost sympathize with Philip. Because, like, if you were going to make a desperate run to Graceland with your wife, and she did die, and, like, you're panicked because you're like, do I want to take her to see Graceland? Like, still, like, bury her there or something? But, like, you're like, I'm holding a dead body. Like, that's illegal and stuff. So, like, I could almost see him panicking and lying, but I'm sure more details are to come.
Oh, okay. So, if you're saying if she did die of natural causes and yeah. you still... Okay, if that were the case,
because, like, I'd be scared, but, like, I mean, if she's dead, I might as well just take her to see Graceland and maybe call the cops there or something. But then if, like...
So, now you got, like, a vacation situation going on, like that Chevy Chase movie.
Oh, okay,
they,
yeah.
They take the one grandma and they just leave her at the cousin's house along the way.
Absolutely. Or... It could have ended up being like really, really fun, and they could have done like a weekend at Bernie's kind of
That's
thing.
That's true.
Right.
They definitely should have done that.
Let's see if you still relate to him after this sentence. This is from Philip himself.
Okay.
As we drove past Graceland, I reached over and finger blasted her in front of Elvis's house. I made that part up.
Oh, shit, dude. I was relating even more to him.
I was going to say, damn, that's a long reach to the trunk. No wonder she...
He put it in neutral. He put the car in neutral, sat in the back of the trunk with her, just finger blasted her as they rolled down a hill.
Well, that's what Twofoy says to me when we go past Graceland.
Yeah, that's first base for Twofoy. When we go past Graceland.
What if he could reach her all the way from the trunk with his long-ass fingers, and that's why she married him?
He's that Guinness guy who never cut his fingernails.
That's
fucking gross.
Have you seen the Jackass video where they pour beer down that guy's fingernails and drink it at the bottom?
Yeah, that's disgusting.
Holy shit. They do what? Like, this guy has fingernails that are like as tall as you, pretty much. Mm. And they're, like, all brown and nasty, and they pour, like, beer at the top of them and run the beer all the way down the fingernails. I think, like, Bam or someone's at the bottom drinking it.
So Philip stated to Ohio police that he placed her body in two large plastic bags because she had wanted to be cremated when she passed away, and her ashes sprinkled to be returned on the earth as soon as possible. He thought it would be better that if he put her in the bags and returned her to earth by putting her in the river. So next, January 9th, which is only 5 days after they left, Sheriff Christopher and two other deputies had gone down to the marshy area around the bridge to try and find the body, but they found no sign of her body anywhere. And keep in mind, when Philip told the police that he threw the body over, he initially told them that he heard her body hit the water and make a splash, so the police have no reason to believe that the body wouldn't be down there, unless...
Unless...
Unless what?
Unless Philip is lying again.
Bullshit.
Since that's kind of his thing.
No, it's not.
No, it's not. So the next day, January 10th, they searched the area by helicopter and still found no signs of Roberta's body anywhere.
Man, this guy fibs so much, I thought he was the star of Futurama, Philip J. Lie.
What? Oh, my God, no.
Whoa.
You know what? Wow. Whatever this guy, we'll find out what he did, but he's fucking 73, and the fact that he could throw another person's body, like, over a bridge or whatever he did, that's pretty impressive.
Absolutely,
because he just looks like an old fucking idiot.
Yeah, I mean, kind of, yeah, he seems like one.
You gotta think that, like, Roberta is also 73, so, like, her bones are, like, hollow and
like
fucking,
a bird.
Yeah, she's pretty much, like, just a plate of fucking spaghetti crashing down over that bridge and spilling.
Since they didn't wait more than 5 days to look, she might just not have hit the ground yet. She may be just gliding.
He put her in a squirrel suit.
She's like Rocky Bullwinkle.
That's just her fucking arms.
Oh. Her skin's that wrinkly and stretchy.
Oh my god, dude. I would love to see a chick with like just super sag titties squirrel suited off a skyscraper.
That would be awesome. And investigators returned once again on the 13th, and they searched the area, and nothing. So now they're getting pretty annoyed and pissed off and starting to believe that Philip may be lying to them again. And here's another quote. Our Benton County Rescue Squad, they went out and drug underneath the bridge and drove over the area searching with boats for about 5 to 6 miles, and they haven't found anything. We are thinking that if this story is true, she may be hung down there, or if the bag is filled with water, it may be holding the bag under the water, or she may be past the search area.
Now, this is on the 13th when this is happening?
Yeah, so Philip and Roberta, their trip was on the 4th, and the police were notified on the 9th about Roberta missing, and then all the searches were between the 9th and 13th.
Because if it's the 13th, if that's a Friday, they shouldn't be on that boat, because... We know what's going to happen.
She never should have been there. She never should have been on there.
That's right.
Dude, I don't know why, but when you first like mentioned this river, I thought it was pretty much like a neighborhood creek. And like he like dropped her in the water, but the water was like 3 inches deep and her body's just laying there. I didn't think it'd be like actually like a river. As soon as you said boats went through, I was like, wait, boats?
Like, where the fuck is she? There's just that one big jungle leaf covering her.
Yeah, but she's been worn smooth by now by the running water.
Oh, yeah.
So now you may be wondering, how did the police initially find out that Roberta was missing? Well, Roberta's brother realized that something was awfully fishy when Philip decided to return home from the Graceland trip without Roberta. And this all started when Philip told me he left her ashes down there, her brother Brian said. She'd always said that when she was cremated, she didn't want her ashes sitting on a mantle. So Philip is just like, he comes back without her. And he's just like, oh, she died and I left her ashes in the river. Which is like, how the fuck could all of that have happened so quickly without no one knowing but you?
At what age do you think you start like saying what you want to happen with your ashes?
I don't know, dude.
I mean, I feel like I've never said that.
I want mine to be like, if I die before all you guys, I want my ashes just to become a fun dip.
Oh,
for all you guys. And it's... Except Andrew.
Yeah.
He gets the stick.
Or Andrew's dick could be the stick.
Oh, never mind, God, Andrew. Yeah. You're back on, baby.
We all take the fun dip.
Super fun dip is what they'll call it, though.
Did I tell you guys what, like, a cousin of mine that showed up to my mom's house, like, about a month ago when I went with my dad's ashes?
No.
Oh, he, like, it's like a cousin that, like, I don't think I've actually ever met. Maybe when I was, like, 5. And, like, he just showed up and was talking to my mom for a couple hours and stuff. And he's like, is it okay if I have a little bit of brother's ashes so I could put it in a joint?
What the fuck?
And she's like, yeah, sure.
Wait, what? No. Why? Yeah. No.
I'm like, how about no, you fucking idiot? It's not how high. You're not going to get fucking help on your SATs because of it.
The weird thing is, I'm pretty sure this isn't the first family member to ask.
What Holy the fuck? Shit, what man. Do you gain by that? That's fucking weird.
Okay, that's what I want done with my ashes.
So do I now.
I don't want it. I don't want it like a joint, though. I want you guys to butt chug it, like how they do with those beers and stuff.
But I want you guys just to rub my ashes all over your mustaches.
Oh my god!
And then record an episode.
Would you want me to smoke your ashes, Kev, and catch a violent J-Buzz?
No. No, dude.
Definitely be Andrews.
Now at this point in the case, Philip Snider, he's not charged with anything because there's no body, and the police don't believe that an actual crime occurred in the area yet. Obviously, they know something weird's going on, and the fact that Philip keeps changing and making up stories doesn't sit well with them either. And whenever he's interviewed, he spits out some bullshit story. And when he makes up other stories and they contradict each other, he just tells a completely different one. So the dude's just like a fucking idiot. He can't keep any of his stories straight. But for right now, they are going with the story that Philip told them, where they believe that Roberta died of natural causes and then he dumped her body over the bridge.
They basically told him, like, we don't believe you. And he's like, you know what, dude, just settle down. It'll all be clear. Philip's song.
He said, he's like, yeah, but many people didn't believe Jesus either.
Was his middle name Shit?
Philip Shit.
I think he's full of shit.
Oh
my god. Hell yeah.
And but he did actually go down to Memphis because they have surveillance footage of him at the Days Inn in Memphis and at the Days Inn in Benton County, which is like, that one's like 145 miles northeast of Memphis. So they show him on surveillance videos at these hotels, but he's alone in all of them.
So wait, on the videos, he was walking in Memphis?
Oh, yeah.
Put on my blue suede shoes.
That's a good song,
my
man.
Favorite part of that song is, they've got catfish on the table. Because that always reminds me, we had this old dude who used to come into the restaurant we worked, and he came in, he'd be like, I don't need a menu, I just want some catfish. And he sits down, like, we don't fucking have catfish, guys. So. Yeah.
Wait, he's done this more than once?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
I don't need a menu, guys, just want to get me some catfish.
Like this,
we don't fucking have catfish,
this
dude.
Old fucker forgot about that catfish as much as this old fucker forgot about killing his wife.
So did you, can you guys kick family members out of the restaurant, or do you just tell your dad not to show up again?
Like, hey, Dad, can you, like, stop coming in and harassing people about catfish? We both know you got buckets of them at home. Just fucking cook those.
The good thing is all we had to do is one person opened the door and we just chucked the Bud Ice out there and he ran and got it. But what sucks is Luke used to work there. So, I mean, we lost a worker for it, but.
All right. So now we're going to fast forward to April 20th, 2018.
Back when I was a young lad.
And even without a body, Philip, he would end up getting booked into the Stark County Jail on one count of aggravated murder with the bond set at $5 million.
I just now realized why you hesitated when you said April 20th.
Yeah, I was
holy
waiting.
Shit,
I catch it.
Man.
I was
Columbine.
Waiting for a joke.
Oh, yeah.
You say Columbine?
Columbine, Hitler's birthday, 420.
Yeah,
you 420. Got
I didn't know Columbine was 420.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's how the whole smoke if you got him got started. Yeah,
dude. Wait, you didn't know? Why do you think Andrew celebrates all on that day every year?
Yeah. He always calls it the Up in Smoke Tour.
Holy shit, man. Oh,
so what happened between January 9th and April 20th that resulted in Philip Snider being arrested for the murder of his wife?
The upcoming road to WrestleMania.
The road to WrestleMania. He pointed, but instead of pointing at the WrestleMania sign, he just pointed at his wife's gravestone.
And then he pointed at the Holiday Inn sign.
And he does that stare. He does that stare that they always do where one looks one way and the other looks the other way, but he was alone.
Oh, fuck yeah. Well, it's pretty funny, actually. We have two things to actually discuss that happened during these months. One, relatives, they found Snider in his basement after attempting to commit suicide by taking medication and placing a bag over his head.
Huh, he couldn't let just time kill him?
I know, dude. Yeah.
Like, come on, man.
And he was admitted to a hospital after that. Later, police...
Too bad he used one of those, like, little mesh bags that, like, marbles come in. So.
He's like,
or onions.
Oh, my God, yes.
But he put that over his dick.
Oh, fuck, yeah. He just stretched his sack over his head.
Before Kevin... Like,
oh, good.
Before Kevin was born, I used to tell his dad that's what condoms were made out of. So he used to just bang out his wife with the onion condom bag.
Well, I can just tell him, like, if he would have asked me, I could have told him that putting your sack over your head doesn't kill you.
No. Dude, it actually
I do
makes
that every
you
Friday.
Stronger.
That's right, man. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger for sure.
And later, police, they use a cadaver dog to search Snyder's condominium. Inside a plastic bin, the dog found a piece of a sweatshirt stained with human blood that matched Roberta Snider.
Oh, shit.
So that is one thing that led to his arrest.
Yeah.
And then number two, this dipshit got catfished by a female police officer, and he ended up admitting guilt to the murder and even goes into detail on literally every single part of her.
Oh, holy shit.
Wait, so he got catfished and admitted a murder to a stranger?
Yes, and the best part is all of that is recorded. And we have the audio recording,
we're
going to play a bunch of those in right here throughout this part.
But who hasn't been there, to be honest with you guys?
I know.
We've all been there.
I know. So here's how it all went down. As far as how the catfishing friendship began, the officer first started by watching Phil and learning his habits and routines. And like most old people, this motherfucker goes to Wendy's a lot. And I fucking like hate going to Wendy's inside to eat because there's always super sad, lonely old people in there eating alone. It just super bums the shit out of me.
And they always like stare at you and smile.
Yeah.
It's kind of weird because like, dude, I know you're not happy, man. Like,
you're either reminiscing about your wife that died like 20 years ago or about a fishing trip you had as a kid.
Or you just looked outside and saw death and you're like, oh, finally.
Oh, shit. You can't get me in the, like, you know how vampires can't enter churches? It's like death can't enter Wendy's. Wendy's. It's like, I'm safe in here until my fucking bedtime at 7:30.
Yeah, he's not allowed in unless he buys a fucking 99 cent Frosty. Which is why they won't let me in.
God damn, Tim, you gotta buy a fucking Frosty if you're gonna hang out here with the old fucks.
I ain't got no fucking money, guys. Sorry.
And next, the female officer, she created a fictional character she referred to as Melissa, and was able to gain the trust of Philip and build a friendship with him.
Do you know? Do we know how, like, how old the officer is?
Yes, we'll mention that in a little bit. She is 50.
Gotcha.
How did she even contact him? Like, did she just like message him? Like, hey, this is Wendy's with a free promotion.
No, she saw, like, she was following him to get his routine and stuff, and learned that he goes to Wendy's like every fucking day, all day.
Oh, so she like in real life catfished, like in person.
Real life catfished him.
She used like something that he's used to, so she used Morse code.
She blinked it at him.
Well, good thing she didn't talk to his wife, or else she'd have to use corpse code.
Damn it, shut up.
He related to the blinking Morse code because of his time in Nam as a POW. But I was going to say, when she created this Melissa character, like, what stats did she choose? Like, what was her charisma?
Her charisma was pretty high because she won Philip over pretty quickly.
Yeah, must have rolled a lot of natural 20s.
And Philip's charisma was pretty high, too. He was very charismatic when he told her about how he was there when rope was invented.
I gotta call my mom and confirm that because that's bullshit. She'd have remembered that fucker.
I'm pretty sure Saddam.
Fuck, I already know where it's going.
Fuck.
Saddam.
It's gonna. I'm trying to make a Saddam Hussein joke.
At least that's a good one, though. Yeah.
So, quote Melissa, she first made small talk with Philip on March 23rd at Wendy's, and then they soon began meeting up regularly. And so Melissa, she was actually a 50-year-old officer, and she looked a lot younger than she was. Now, Philip, he had gray hair, partially bald, and he had just an old person voice. He's old as shit. And when people saw them at a table, people assumed they were like father and daughter.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
But Philip, he was getting different ideas. And whenever Melissa was undercover, she didn't wear like any makeup or anything like that. She would show up in like sweatpants and workout clothes and just tried to appear like a regular average girl, and I guess that really worked for Philip.
She worked out at Average Joe's gym.
And she told Philip that she was moving from Cincinnati to care for her mom until she died, and after her mom passed away, there'd be a large inheritance for her, and so she was just kind of waiting for her to pass away. And part of her story was also that she was divorced, and she was a mother of grown children. And all this is just a fucking ruse to try to, like, work her way into getting him to confess.
Absolutely.
But put yourself in his shoes. Like, some decently younger, attractive girl comes up to you and tells you that she has one lump sum. What would you do?
Hi, it's Jamie, Progressive's Employee of the Month, 2 months in a row. Leave a message at the... Hi, Jamie. It's me, Jamie. I just had a new idea for our song about the Name Your Price tool. So when it's like, tell us what you want to pay, hey, 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 and the trombone goes, blah, 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 and you say, we'll help you find coverage options to fit your budget. Then we just all do finger snaps while a choir goes, savings coming at ya, savings coming at ya. Yes? No? Maybe? Anyway, see your practice tonight. I got new lyrics for the rap break.
Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
And then as days go by, they would hang out at different fast food places, and she would just keep asking him questions, and he just fucking ate it all up. Just ate that up as he ate up his fucking Wendy's value meals every day. And then she began asking him about his wife. And at first, he was acting like, oh, no, this is way too much for me. Like, I'm really sensitive to this subject. This is a very sensitive subject. And then he blasted fucking just the two of us by Will Powers. Smith.
Fuck yeah.
How like stupid is this fucking guy though? Like he's the cops have interrogated you and everything. Yeah, and this chick just shows up all of a sudden and wants to like bang your old balls out. And you're like, I'm down for this.
Well, she didn't even exactly do that either. Like it only took like roughly a month of meeting up with him. And like they would only meet up at like McDonald's and Wendy's and other fast food places. And they started contacting each other by phone and text. And she would always just bombard him with a bunch of questions about his wife's death. And this fucking idiot, he had no clue that he was just getting played this entire time. And then on the big day, April 20th, which is when he got arrested, Melissa, she set up a small get-together with Philip at the McDonald's in Kent. And thanks to this officer, she recorded the conversation with him where he confesses to the murder. So we get to fucking listen to that because it's pretty good.
So not only did she get him to confess to a murder, but she also gave this motherfucker diarrhea. Because it's at McDonald's. Yes.
And like, I guess during this, like Melissa was like, I wouldn't normally agree to this. Like, I'm not going to go to McDonald's to see this old fucker every day. But the McRib was back. So she did this whole thing pro bono.
Which is the only reason I saw all this happen.
Yeah, dude, I was chasing you around in the fucking play place in the ball pit with our McRibs and our dicks out.
Oh, yeah, dude.
I think I heard you whisper to Tim, I want to tickle your McRib.
Oh, yeah, because remember right after I removed one of my McRibs to suck your dick? Just like Marilyn Manson.
That's right.
So this is really fucking weird and creepy, but this is how he greets her. She walks in to sit down with him, and he says, hello there, little girl. And then she says, oh, good morning, how are you? Peachy keen or hunky dory?
The fuck?
That's his fucking introduction to her. All right, that's how... Even that then, I would have been like, we don't even need the confession, you're a fucking piece of shit.
You just murdered something by saying that.
And, never mind, I was trying to think of a way to add in, ain't that a peach? But I don't know how to do that.
And this McDonald's that they were at didn't have a playpen thing, but it did have a sandbox. It was her vagina because it dried up as soon as she heard that.
Yeah. Oh, dude, now it's good though, because I mean, a lot of girls turn me down, but I'm just gonna tell everybody, like, man, I said exactly what that guy just said, and that's why I got turned down, and it wasn't because of my looks.
That greeting is almost as bad as one feels like a duck in all this wet.
Wait, what the fuck is that? I've never heard that.
It's from a John Mulaney.
Oh my god,
so good.
Yeah.
Dude, I had this one manager. It was this fucking idiot, dude. I know you kind of like him, Tim.
Yeah.
So this manager, it was like raining and it was real shitty outside. I was like, man, this weather sucks. She's like, yeah. Actually, no, it doesn't, Kevin. Not if you're a duck. And I was like, I had to like fake laugh at how dumb it was. And then later on, he told me about how like he's like, yeah, I want to get this green car and just paint a giant dragon on it. I was like, yeah, dude, that'll get you laid. Definitely.
Oh, my God.
We can pretty 75% chance this guy liked men, though.
Yeah, he looked like Greg Proops from Whose Line Is It Anyway?
Yeah.
But, like, if he fell, like, face first into, like, a blender and then gained, like, a lot of weight because
of it
somehow.
Wait a minute. Was Greg?
No, wait a minute. No, too, if it wasn't you. I didn't mean that too.
Was Greg Proops someone with the glasses?
Yeah.
Didn't Patchell kind of look like him?
Kind of, yeah.
No, kind of. Yeah.
I can see it. Probably just because they both have glasses.
Oh, so a wuss. Melissa shows up and then she goes to the counter. She buys a 99-cent coffee, and then she sits down with Mr. Snider for an hour and 14 minutes. And that was all it took for her to get a full confession, which would then lead to Philip getting arrested. But how did she get him to confess to it all? Well, she first tried prompting him to confess by telling him that she was staying in the area to take care of her sick mother. And then she told him that she just thought of killing her.
Oh, man, that actually is a pretty good way to get it out of him.
To which Philip offered up ways to commit the murder and dispose of the body without raising any suspicion. Which I guarantee his plan was like, okay, well, here's what I did. Just do the fucking opposite because my dumbass couldn't fucking do it.
What if she told him, she's like, hey, I've been listening to ICP. Actually, you probably know about them. They were cool when you were 15. She's like, I just heard this song called Confessions.
Coming to this joke is going to get no laugh out of anyone listening except Tim. Oh. But listening to Philip like offer up ways to get away with murder would be like listening to Shelley Duncan telling you how to not strike out every fucking game.
Yes, fuck that's yeah, so dumb. Dude.
No, that's amazing.
One time at an Indians game, me and Tim were there and we were cheering on. We were like super close and we kept cheering on Shelley Duncan every time he went. He went up like four times, struck out every time. And as soon as he struck out, he turned and fucking stared us down his entire walk back.
Like, stared us down like we did something wrong. And we were yelling, like, we didn't do anything, Shelly.
Like, we didn't fucking do it. And then, but we kept staring at his ass, remember? I can't stop staring at his ass.
Oh, my God.
Every time he came out, we're like, dude, just look at
his fucking ass, dude. He's going to get a grand slam, and he fucking strikes out and stares us down. We didn't fucking do it, man.
Dude, it's good that I'm not getting laid now, because after admitting that, I'm never getting laid again. unless it's from Shelly Duncan. Which, if so, then it's worth it.
So, Philip, he finally decided to describe how he killed his wife, Roberta. So, first, on January 2nd, he stated they got into a fight about something. And this resulted in Roberta sleeping on the love seat in the living room of their home. Philip, he then woke up early the next morning. To the surprise of fucking nobody, he went out to Burger King to get a coffee. And then he returned home to find his wife still asleep on the love seat.
Why is it called a love seat? Like you sit next to it because there's only two people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's any seat could be a love seat. Yeah. I guess, if you live with Jeremiah.
Oh, Jeremiah usually is my love seat.
Oh, yeah.
Sit on that a lot.
Get a lot of agony of the love seat.
Oh, fuck yeah, dude.
And next, Philip, he took a shop cloth and he quietly and very gently placed it over her sleeping head. He then struck her twice in the head with a 2-pound stake hammer. Killing her. Snider next told the undercover investigator that he tied a plastic grocery bag over Roberta's head and rolled her body onto a plastic tarp before loading her body into his pickup truck. And keep in mind, this is all recorded. We're going to play audio of this. He's telling her this at a fucking McDonald's.
Yeah, like even
you
if
hear
she's
people
not,
just
yeah.
in the background yeah. talking, hanging out. He's just saying all this at a McDonald's.
Yeah, one of these motherfuckers is going to like hear something, even if she wasn't going to tell.
Yeah, that's pretty crazy.
Hashtag wild man.
Hashtag wild man.
Wait a minute.
Yeah.
But was he driving a car? Because I thought she was in the trunk.
Pickup truck.
Oh, okay.
Well, he never took the trip with her, though.
Okay.
Because he killed her before. He might have taken her body whenever he drove down there.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
We'll get to that a little bit later. So quickly, he's arrested, and he would end up pleading guilty to aggravated murder, tampering with evidence, and gross abuse of a corpse. And he ended up taking a plea agreement and getting 20 years with the possibility of parole after the 20 years.
Holy
but this
shit.
Is just a life sentence. He's old as fuck. He's not going to live another 20 years.
Yeah.
And as part of the plea agreement for the 20 years, he is required to show investigators where he dumped the body. And the fucked up thing is like police, they were constantly coming to his house, searching around the place. They were giving him polygraph tests and interviewing him. And for some of the interviews, he's sitting on the bloodstained love seat where he murdered his wife. So there's like bloodstains on like the pillows and shit. And he's just sitting there while he's telling the police like lies and lies and stuff.
Yeah, it's pretty messed up.
And of course, the polygraph tests, he fucking bombs them and fails. I mean, I don't put any stake in a polygraph test at all. I think they're stupid. But he just fucking bombs them. So that's pretty funny.
Well, I mean, if that were true, Maury wouldn't have a job.
So. That is true, dude.
Yeah. Don't they do a lot of like?
Yeah,
I thought they did.
Oh yeah,
and there would only be 150 Pokemon. Is there one called like Polygraph or something like that?
it's Polygon. Like Polygon.
It's
like yeah,
yeah
something
close
like
enough.
That. Close enough. And the whole time they said Snider, he hadn't expressed an ounce of remorse for killing his wife. And after his sentencing, the judge told him the hottest places in hell are reserved for people like you. That's a pretty good F you to send him off. So now we do have some random info. Do you guys have anything you want to mention about that so far? We do have some more information to talk about this case. So
I just can't believe someone just admitting, like, I'm pretty sure if I murdered someone, even if I murdered someone with, like, a friend, I don't think I'd still ever talk about it with them,
and
let alone a stranger.
At a fucking...
Well, I'm trying to bang, maybe, you know.
at a fucking McDonald's.
Wait, we talk about Andrew all the time, though.
But it's like in a public place. Like, he's just doing it at a fucking McDonald's. And this is at like 8:30 in the morning. So there's going to be people everywhere.
Did she just arrest him on the spot right there and then?
No. We'll actually talk about how he got arrested. It's kind of funny.
Okay.
The best part of waking up is talking about my murder with a coffee cup.
So Philip, in case you can't guess, he's super fucking dumb. One time, Melissa showed up wearing her wedding ring, and he was like, hey, what's that? And she like had to think quick. She told him, oh, it's from my failed marriage. I wore it because I wanted to pawn it, and I thought you might know how much it's worth. And he fucking believed her, bought
Holy
that shit up.
Shit, man. It really has to be that he just thinks she's hot.
Probably.
I mean, because that does kind of change like how a dude thinks. But
yeah,
I don't care how fucking hot you are. If I murdered somebody, I'm not telling you shit. I don't care if it's Emma Watson asking me. You're not finding it out.
That's true.
What if she's like, oh yeah, I just got back from McDonald's and this is one of the toys you get for the Happy Meal.
He probably would be like, all
right.
Yeah.
He straight whips it out and jerks it right there.
He's like, I don't think so. I went there 7 times yesterday and I didn't see anything on the menu about no ring.
he has all the McDonald's Beanie Babies.
This motherfucker's like buying his only kids' friends. Meals.
Also, twice he asked her if she was a police officer, to which she joked and said, yeah, I work for the CIA, and laughed, brushing it off.
Nice.
And then the second time she was like, do I look like a police officer? So she never even like she never said no, which is hilarious.
Fuck yes.
And one time at a donut shop, she asked the employees to bring out like a special order for them and had them sing happy birthday. And they brought out like a little cake or something and they had like candles lit. And that was like the friendliest thing she did was that. And he fucking confessed to murder. And that was like that's all it took. It was a fucking donut with like 3 candles in it.
I'm trying to think of, like, bigger losers. Like I was walking down the street, and I accidentally, like, bumped shoulders with a girl, and I hurry up and spun around and dropped to my knee, and I was like, will you marry me? That's pretty much what this guy did.
I want to see this guy just doing, like, the Spider-Man 3 scene after he's, like, Peter's supposed to be cool, and he walks down the street doing, like, the finger guns and the air humps. I want to see him doing that, but he's just walking to fucking Wendy's every morning.
What if
and he's just pointing at the gravestones of all his old fucking friends that have already died.
What if he does the Spider-Man 1 scene and he like comes down in the alley on the web like upside down to go kiss her, but he's obviously not Spider-Man, so he doesn't have web, so he's using McDonald's toilet paper to roll down, but it's so fucking thin and shitty he just falls because it breaks.
He does that and he's hanging down, but earlier he got one of his ribs removed, so he just hangs down and sucks his own dick.
He's in the bathroom. He's like, go, Web, go. But actually, it's just trying to get himself to piss. Like, he's out because he's old.
He's at the fucking library on the computer trying to figure out why, like, what is all's wrong with him because he's fucking old as fucking dying. He's like, go, Web MD, go.
All right, this one's going to take a little bit of, like, visual creativity for you guys.
Okay.
So what if Spider-Man 1 scene when Roberta comes down the web,
oh,
but she's so old and her tits are so big and saggy that they drop down upside down and she looks like a giant capital H. Yeah.
So we said that, like when Philip was doing the Spider-Man 3 entrance, he's like, he's walking around, he keeps pointing to like gravestones, like where all of his like his family and friends and acquaintances that passed away are. Yeah. Well, they haven't seen him for like 2 weeks. Like, where the fuck is Philip? Where's he been? They're like, oh, he just went on the Gettysburg tour.
Holy shit.
He fucking knew every single one of them.
Well, that took like 1 week. And then the other week, because he loves going to McDonald's and stuff, and he went there and he tried to order an ice cream cone, and fucker wasn't working.
It's never working,
dude. So that was the other week.
Or how about the part in Spider-Man 1 when Philip's like little nephew was there with him and he saw Roberta and he was like, Uncle Phil, is that an angel? And he's like, Philip was like, well, she will be soon.
Oh man.
And that was Will Smith.
What about Philip and Roberta are so fucking old that on their way down to Graceland, they stopped at in Kentucky and went to that Noah's Ark recreation thing and said goodbye to all their pets.
They stopped at the Noah's Ark. He's like, no, that's not even how I built this fucking ark. It looked way different. So during one of the meetups,
Bible says gopher wood, but actually it was just particle board.
And during one of the meetups of the undercover officer, Philip, like during a card game, just out of nowhere, started to talk about how long it took for a body to decompose. And they said that he, quote, almost expertly talked about like the human heart and oxygen levels and blood loss and the stages of like people dying. But they later on said that they think he learned all that just from television.
Or from looking at his own body. Yeah. He's like, well, my body's decomposing like this.
Like, they think he's like, oh, my God, he's the fucking smartest man in the world. And that's just because he went to the fair and went through the House of Mirrors once.
Like, he's so old and thin that he's see-through like one of those glass fish. And that's how he knew about all the anatomy. But he's just look down and see it pumping.
He's just fucking Slim Goodbody walking around.
Oh my gosh. Like off yours, he's so old and thin in third grade, I used to use him to trace my fucking favorite shapes and objects. That's where he got all his tattoos from.
No, we're talking about Philip, not like an old, wet cum sock.
Oh, yeah.
I remember he used to be a substitute teacher back in my school. And I remember another teacher was yelling at these kids because they thought that these kids were like smacking the chalkboard erasers in the hallway. And they came out like, what are you doing? But it was just Philip. He just farted.
That's so dumb.
So as our meetings went on, Philip, he opened up more and more, and he told her that he wouldn't share any of this with his counselor or psychiatrist, but he went on to tell her about it. And discussions about where he put his wife's body got brought up, and he said, like, he mentioned the Tennessee River story, and he also mentioned a Kentucky landfill.
Wait, so he actually lied to her, too?
Well, he started telling her about how he told the Tennessee River story and saying, like, she could also possibly be in a Kentucky landfill.
Yeah, his old ass at this point probably doesn't remember.
I know.
The only thing he fucking remembers at this point is a fast food menu.
Dude, I keep thinking, like, Kentucky landfill is like a sexual position. It's like when you buy your girl KFC and you stick the legs in her pussy and ass at the same time.
What the fuck?
Yeah, Kentucky landfill.
Oh, my God.
Dude, I was already grossed out by the when you buy your girlfriend KFC because that shit's fucking gross.
Dude.
Not the when you stick the drumstick in her pussy?
No, that seemed normal to me.
And you, never mind, that didn't even make sense. I was going to say, you pull the drumstick out and the bone's gone, but that wouldn't make any fucking sense.
You pull the drumstick out and the gravy's already on it.
You take like the ice cream drumstick, you put it in her pussy and pull it out, and it looks like the fucking KFC one afterwards. Okay.
And that's when your mom got banned from Chatterbait.
I know, that's what sucked is because after that she had to get a real job.
Then she just joined my mom's Chatterbait and wore a mask.
Philip even told her about how he had to clean up stains in the floor of their home and in his truck using soap and Clorox.
They're old as fuck. There was probably a lot more stains in the floor.
And then he followed up with, I gotta quit telling you this. And then he quickly added, I didn't kill her. And then Melissa's like, I feel like we have a connection. I feel like I can trust you. And then Philip adds in, I feel like I've known you for many years.
Oh, fuck yes.
What a fucking old piece of shit.
This all happened this year.
Yeah.
Like, dude. We were doing shit on the same day that this
dude, we were
happening.
Doing a podcast, I'm sure.
Yeah, we were.
Yeah. During one of their meetups, Philip said, you know, I have a bizarre idea. And Melissa, she's like nimbly and playfully, she says, I love bizarre ideas. And then Philip suggested they enter into a marriage of convenience so that after he dies, she can receive $900 a month from his pension. And he's like, oh, it's just an idea. And he's like, we won't even need to get frisky. And like they kind of like laughed about it. She's like, man. Oh, good, because I'm not a frisky kind of person.
Wow.
But he's like trying to get her to like marry him now.
Jesus. This is after he told her about killing his wife, right?
Yes.
Yeah, because I mean, you know, it went well last time he got married. Might as well do it.
So I'm going to tell you guys what it says, but I'm going to play the audio whenever I edit this. But after talk of marriage ceased, she went back to her favorite subject. You're going to tell me, though, how it happened, aren't you? And then Snider teased back, after I get to Cincinnati, I'll tell you how it happened. Because that's where she says she's living.
Yeah.
And he's like trying to fucking like move in with her and shit.
Scenario-wise, hit her in the head. What'd you hit her with? Lamp?
Oh, you blinked before me.
What?
No.
What'd you hit her with?
I can't tell you that.
Why?
We aren't married.
Well, just, I mean, I know all the other stuff. It's just about curious. I'm just curious. And I want to get, honestly, I'm like consumed about it because I could picture myself being there, but I can't picture what it was. You know, I could picture myself standing there watching, but I don't know exactly what happened.
Can you imagine a hammer this big and this big round?
Like a mallet?
Yeah, steel.
Yeah.
If you would pound steel stakes in the ground.
Yes.
Can you imagine that?
Yes. They're heavy though, aren't they?
2 pounds.
Okay.
Just scenario.
Right.
Say I bonked her in the head.
Right.
And her tongue came out. Just scenario.
Right.
And I put a bag over her head.
To make sure that all the...
And the blood went on the pillow. It's like a pillow you lay on the couch.
Oh, like a throw pillow-like?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, like for decoration.
Yeah.
Yeah. Was there a lot of blood on
it? No. Okay. It was...
Enough.
Enough. Yeah, I put the pillow in a plastic bag. And the scenario.
Right.
The scenario.
Right.
Yeah, that would have happened.
Right.
And I put it in a Rubbermaid, the scenario.
Right.
Container. And put it in the back of the truck.
In a separate one than you put her?
Separate.
Okay.
The scenario.
Right, right.
And the lampshade.
And the lampshade just had blood on it. Okay, which is, it's good that you noticed that.
I do.
Yeah.
Just scenarios. So
right,
I said,
right.
Oh, shit.
And I'd say, oh, shit. I'd say that like 10,000 times.
Anyway. Yeah.
So, was she sleeping when you hit her in the head, or were you fighting?
She was asleep.
Yeah.
Just a scenario.
Right, right. On the couch?
Just a scenario.
But were you worried about the couch having blood on it?
I didn't care.
Right.
It was a love seat.
Okay. Front of the head? Side of the head?
Just a scenario.
Yes.
Right there.
Right
there. Oh.
But was there, like, I could imagine it going...
No.
No?
Just scenario.
Yeah.
You can buy these, it's like a cloth, it's like a wash rag, but it's not really a wash rag. It's like something that you would use on your truck or car.
Oh, like the...
like this big.
Are they red?
They're different colors. Blue, yellow,
like
green.
That soak up a lot of, to soak up a lot of, I can't, chamois or something like that.
Kind
of
like that, but it's like a cotton cloth.
Okay. Yeah.
Let's just say, scenario.
Yeah.
I gently laid one of those on the side of her head.
Before?
Before.
So it just took one hit? And that was it?
And that was it.
Yeah. And then you rolled her on the plastic and then put the plastic bag over her head?
And the bag went on her head right away. Just try to stop anything, and then I tied it around her neck.
Yeah. So that it...
Just scenario.
Right, right. But you did all that on the couch. Or the love.
Just
right, right. Weren't you worried about the love? I'd almost want to load the love seat up in the truck and take it too.
Then it would be noticed.
Oh.
The love seat is in my apartment.
Yeah, see, I'd be worried, but did they even look at it?
There wasn't nothing on it.
Because you had the towel.
I got lucky.
You did get lucky. Yeah, because
so
it could have been.
Pillows, there's one pillow on top of another pillow.
Yeah.
Both of those pillows, the scenario.
Yeah.
I possibly could have put them in a bag. Put them in a Rubbermaid container.
Yeah.
And shoved it up in the back of the truck.
And then when Melissa asked if he killed her, he said, maybe. Scenario-wise, just a scenario was a phrase that he had used frequently in past discussions about his wife's death and direct role in it.
That means he's escaping it, man. That's not testimony. That's just, you know, what if?
And before they parted, the elderly man, he asked her, he's like, I think I should get a peck on the cheek. A nice big wet one, he said playfully. Only if what you told me is the truth, she bargained. It is, he replied.
What a sick fucker.
What a fucking piece of shit.
Dude, did she kiss him on the cheek?
Yeah, I think she did.
Oh, dude.
She was an actress.
Yeah.
What a fucking actress.
I hope she had her polio shots.
Tell me.
You owe me
a lot of trust.
A peck on the cheek.
I do. Yes, I do.
On the way out of here.
Okay. Yes. It's my turn? You
nice
sure?
Big wet one.
Only if what you told me was the truth.
It is.
Now, that was early in the morning, like real early, I think like 8:30. So at around 10 a.m. that day, Snider, he drove off. Oh, no, this is at 10 a.m. This is right after that.
Yeah.
Philip, he drove off. He honks and waves at her. And then authorities, they started listening to the audio and they obtained an arrest warrant right away for aggravated murder. And they tracked him down at 3 p.m. later that day at fucking Burger King.
Holy shit, dude. Yeah. He wasn't in bed yet? Staying up late to go to Burger King.
That says a fourth meal.
So this fucker's only at Wendy's, Burger King, and McDonald's all day.
I mean, at that point, though, might as well.
So
it's almost like he's filming a documentary for Super Size Me 2.
And so the police chief and a sergeant, they went into the Burger King to visit him. And Snider, he was sitting there in a booth. He had his arms spread wide and his feet were propped up on the opposite side of the bench. And he was sitting there drinking a coffee. And the officers walk up to him. They say, how are you doing, Phil? He replies back, peachy keen.
God. Jesus, man.
Peachy keen, they repeated back. That good? Yeah, that good. Are you ready to talk? No, not yet. They sat down in the next booth over. Well, you're probably going to be less peachy keen in a second because you're under arrest. To which Philip says, for what?
God, yes.
And yeah. Then seconds later, they handcuffed him and escorted him out in a cruiser.
Dude, I like how he didn't even have to have been talking to an undercover cop. He was saying this shit at McDonald's.
Yeah.
Like, it could have just been, the fucking person right behind you heard everything you said, you fucking idiot.
This was 5 hours after admitting in public that he murdered his wife, and they're being like, you're under arrest.
He's like, for what? For what? You didn't see me fucking drive through that stop sign, you prick.
What if they're like, you know we got you, right? And he's like, for what? And he's like, you're under arrest. He's like, you know what? I didn't know it was illegal to torrent Sugar Ray CDs, okay? I thought that shit was free.
It's illegal to do anything with Sugar Ray CDs, man.
The sheriff's like, you motherfucker, we should just lynch you right here. And so you may be wondering, where is Roberta's body? Because as part of the plea deal, he has to show them where the body is.
Yeah. Can I get three guesses real quick?
Yes.
The dumpster of McDonald's, Burger King, or Wendy's?
Well, as of September 7th, the last thing we know is that Philip said he dumped her body into a dumpster
holy shit.
In Bullitt County, Kentucky. And from there, the body most likely ended up in a nearby landfill. So who the fuck knows? They have no idea.
Dude, it had to have been a fast food restaurant.
How the fuck did he lift this lady's body in there? Like, I'm kind of impressed that this old fucker could do that.
Yeah, unless he...
Just from our restaurant days, having to dump the trash there.
I know. Those sucked.
What was that thing behind the dumpster? Was it like a grease dumpster?
Grease thing.
Grease trap, they call it.
Imagine like being alive and being dumped in there.
Yeah, that would suck.
Or suck.
Just touching it with your hand.
Ew. Yeah, so this poor lady, she gets murdered by her husband, and now her family doesn't even have a body to give her like a proper burial or put her to rest. And they had a son. So the son, he lost both his mother and his father, and he had to like speak at the during the court and everything. It just sucks. Like, this dude just, he's like, they're fucking old as fuck. Why kill her? Like, just pieces of shit.
I know losing your mom is worse, but also finding out that your dad, not even only is just a murderer, but that he's that much of a fucking idiot.
Yeah.
That would suck.
Yeah, the dude's fucking dumb. I can show you a clip of him real quick.
I think I'd be more embarrassed if my stepdad went to McDonald's every day.
I remember one time, this is back when we were like young, just young shits, and back during Tooth's fucking super crazy days.
Oh, when this story is going on?
Yeah, January of this year. So there was always, like Tooth mentioned, there was always like six old fuckers that would hang outside McDonald's, like in the parking lot, all day, every day. And one time we drove by, and Tooth yelled out the window, like, you know, the thing you do with, like, the peace sign, but it's facing you, and you stick your tongue through, so it's like you're eating, like, it means like you're eating out of chick.
Yeah.
And Tooth's like, hey, this is for your wife. And this guy is so tall, and he flipped Tooth off by lifting his middle finger as high as he could in the air, and just flipped him off, like, reaching as high as he could.
Oh, I forgot all about that.
This
That's
is
a good
for
one.
Your wife. Dude, Tooth used to be fucking crazy. One time he rolled up a floor mat and had like his shirt pulled up over his head and acted like it was a machine gun, and he'd fucking aim it out the window at people.
Yeah, we would drive through like town, and I really yell, "This is a gun! I'm going to shoot you."
Yeah, that's what he said. He's like, "This is a gun! I'm gonna fucking shoot you." What a beast! Old Tooth was
fucking
insane.
Old Tooth, man. I met Old Tooth for like 2 weeks.
Oh God, yes.
So before we jump into Spence giving our closing shit, we didn't have any new Patreon signups this week. However, huge shout out to Bug on Patreon. And if you hear this and it was an accident or a glitch, I don't fucking know what happened, because our different subscriptions are $1 or $5 a month, and she was already at $5 a month. She fucking upped that again. Like, I didn't even know you could do it.
Yeah.
So she just decided to give us fucking more for no reason.
What? Wow.
We got to create a new tier.
So that's super fucking cool. If that was an accident, let me know and I'll fucking change it.
Yeah,
but
for
if
sure.
not, let us know what you want for that. We'll cover a topic
for
you.
We'll do pretty much anything. We'll
send nudes.
We'll do like a bonus Patreon episode if you have any questions or wants to talk about anything. Whatever you want, we'll do.
Anybody you want dead, just let us know.
Spencer, you said we need to create a new tier, right?
Yeah.
So she keeps upping the ante. So we have to keep we're pretty much trailing her, right?
Mm-hmm.
So like we have to keep making new tiers. So like she's pretty much like making the trail of tiers for us.
It's exactly like that.
Pretty much.
Alrighty, on to our honorary brother of the week. And if you want to be an honorary brother, all you have to do is leave us a 5-star review on iTunes, and we just pick from there in order. And leaving us a 5-star review on iTunes, it really helps us out. It helps out the show tremendously. Like, it'll put us on charts maybe one day eventually, but I really doubt it. We'll probably never be on charts, except for in Hong Kong. For some reason, in comedy charts in Hong Kong, we're at like 106.
Yeah, for some reason.
I think it's because you probably posted a selfie of yourself.
Yeah.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, that has to be it.
Yeah, because I was naked from the waist down.
I was going to say if my dick was on there.
And they're
beat
like,
me to it.
Oh, one of us. So here we go. Honorary Brother of the Week, Miss Heather C., which I believe is Heather Curley. I'm guessing.
Who's
one
that?
Of our Patreon members.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
So, Miss Heather C. with the topic title, Can't Get Enough, hashtag Wildman.
Wait a
love
minute.
It already.
Was she already a Patreon member before?
There was two Curlies.
Oh, because the song.
Yeah.
Okay, that's great. Right.
I found this podcast by total accident, and now it's my favorite thing, period. The stories are brilliant, and the guys are hilarious. Murder and mayhem, check. Singing, check. Dancing, I can only hope. just a top-notch podcast and the best dark humor. Love these guys.
Oh, fuck yeah, dude. So, there's definitely Nancy.
Thank you. That was super cool. That was super awesome, awesome fucking review. So thank you.
Yeah, we like it. I like it. I love it. I want some more of it.
Finally, you're speaking your native tongue.
I tried so hard not to say the N-word.
Oh, my God.
So, Tim, that screenshot I sent you earlier was her, actually.
Dude, holy shit, that was awesome.
And I didn't send you the second one, because she was talking about, like, the drinking game and stuff.
Wait, the second one, did she call me an idiot?
No, she said, because we were talking about she's like, oh, there needs to be a Brothers Commonplace drinking game. Like, yeah. You drink every time Tim says holy shit.
Which is, like, every time, you're dead there.
Every time Kevin makes a questionable life decision or the Family Matters treadmill episode is referenced, and like keeps going on and on.
You're dead twice.
And then she replied, based on Tim alone, we'd be making inappropriate Mr. Hands references and drunk texting my mom in like 10 minutes. So anything before us, Spence does our closing shit?
I don't think so.
Thanks for upping the ante, Patreon member.
You great person, you.
We're like the odd lots of podcasts now. Well, thank you, everybody, for listening to yet another episode of the Brothers Commonplace. We love all of our supporters. We love our listeners. We love all the ideas and feedback we get from you guys, and we'd love to hear more of it. And the way you can do that is hit us up on social media. You can find us on Facebook, Twitter. You can follow Kevin on Instagram. He gives you updates about the podcast there. Check us out wherever you find podcasts and leave us a review, especially iTunes, but anywhere. And let us know when you send a review. Drop us a note and you may become another honorary brother. If you'd like to go the extra mile, you can support us on Patreon. We have a $1 a month level and a $5 a month level, and you get bonus episodes if you're at the, what, $5 a month level?
No.
No, you get bonus for everything.
You get bonus for everything, people. Mm.
The only difference is with the $5, we give you a shout out on here, which because we wanted everyone to get everything. And also, I mail you some stickers and I write you a personalized thank you note. And that's pretty much it. It just really helps us out.
We blow you a kiss.
Absolutely. Oh, we're definitely blowing you a kiss.
Also, if you're a $5 member and you do send a picture of yourself, if you're female, I do send cum tributes out.
No.
Toof keeps his cum like refrigerated in like the little rack thing that Newman steals the DNA from in Jurassic Park. With like the little vials all lined up. He's like, which ones to steal? He pulls out like takes some Velociraptor, takes some T-Rex. Toof just keeps different cum samples. And like he opens it up and like steam comes pouring out. Like somehow there's cold steam.
It's like when Wesley Snipes pulls that sewer grate off in Demolition Man.
Yeah.
Dude, my favorite part of Demolition Man is where this scene, I don't know why it's in the movie, but he's at like a museum or something, and this group of Asians walk by, and he looks at him and just goes ting tong ting tong, and that's it.
Oh yeah,
there's no point to that besides being racist.
That would never slide nowadays.
No, it's so fucking good.
I mean, it's kind of like the movie Titan A.E., which few people have seen. Cartoon.
It's actually a really good movie.
It is a good movie, and Earth gets destroyed, and they send out this spaceship with all the DNA to like recreate a new Earth with all the species on it. But it was unfortunate that it got mixed up. It was just all Toof cum, so they just cloned a whole bunch of Toofs.
Oh, God, yeah. No, that wasn't on
the planet at the end.
That's how Australia was created. Dude, my favorite part about that Demolition Man thing is I was watching with Kevin in the theaters, and I was like, wow, just ching chang, whatever. That's so racist. And Kevin's like, well, I actually understood what he said. He just said, how you guys doing? I didn't know you speak your native language.
So yeah, special thanks to everyone that has already left us a review on iTunes or Apple Podcasts or any other platform. And special thanks to everyone that has signed up for our Patreon. It really means a lot to us. And just anyone that's reached out to us just to say they're a fan of the show or they enjoy listening, that really just means the world to us. It's super cool. And keep on listening and keep sharing with your friends. And yeah, we really appreciate it. So thank you.
So this whole time while Spence was talking and Kev was talking, I didn't think of anything to say.
Dude, I thought that was Lyra wooing like Ric Flair.
Wow. So yeah, I didn't think much to say at all, but you guys are great. Definitely keep subscribing to, you know, iTunes or whatever Spence said to do, and the Patreon and all that.
You know what, Tim? For some reason, I don't buy you being appreciative right now. I don't fucking buy that act.
You don't sound genuine at all.
We watch movies sometimes, and we tell you guys how much we hated them.
Well, speaking of next movie review we do for Patreon, well, we have one coming up called Don't Answer the Phone. That should be up by the time you hear this. And the next one we're doing is Drop Dead Gorgeous. It was a request by one of our Patreon members. So
I already know now that it's better than Don't Answer the Phone.
Yeah, Don't Answer the Phone is...
I wouldn't even just not answer the phone. Just don't watch that movie.
Don't. It's one of the worst movies I've ever seen.
It's fucking terrible.
Don't. Sorry, too.
I fucking hate you guys. You know what? Harry Potter is the worst movie ever, too. How you guys like that, huh?
Well, you know
Harry Potter is like... seven or eight movies. Yeah,
they didn't make an entire fucking park for Don't Answer the Phone.
Dude, wait. Imagine if they did.
It would suck, dude.
Imagine all it would be is saggy boobs and that would be it.
That's it.
Would there be anything else?
No.
I'd go there.
Okay. Yeah, because it'd probably be your fucking house.
So wait,
it'll just be the nursing home that our moms end up at. Dude,
what if it's like Field of Dreams where I just build it?
You build it and then you come.
Dude, it's like me making a sex doll of the guy who's starring the movie. If I build it, I will come.
Alrighty, too.
I was going to say it's just Top Hat, but both your guys' jokes was better than mine.
Oh, God, Top Hat.
Alright, too. If I want you to hit us, hard with some words of wisdom, brother.
Alright, so to some of our listeners out there, some pretty cool people, and they really like what we do, that they send us in stuff. We've gotten like frisbees, magnets, all kinds of things.
Oh yeah, it's P.O. Box 31, Nova, Ohio 44859 if you want to send us anything.
Yeah, and this is made up. We don't really do this with the stuff. But like me and Andrew, we kind of been staking outside that... we've been staking outside that address.
Oh, okay.
And we've been intercepting those packages. And me and Andrew started this site where he takes all the Brothers Commonplace items or stuff that people sends us and he eats it. And we live film it. And he eats all the stuff. And the goal is to eat it all and like with a bunch of Taco Bell and stuff and keep it in his stomach for 7 days. And then he shits it all out every Sunday when a podcast is out. And Andrew's kind of a pussy, so sometimes he can't make it the whole 7 days. But we still named the site that we do this on A Weak Stomach.
Okay, all right. I don't know why I thought there was going to be like a package sniffing joke.
Oh, dude.
Like package sniffing dogs, but there's no dogs.
No,
like it's
good.
Just you and Andrew. Good, yeah. That's what I thought it was going towards. Fuck yeah, dude.
It's too difficult to get a collar on them.
The only thing me and Andrew lock up is the chastity belts on our wieners.
Oh, yeah. That are completely unnecessary.
Holy shit, you beat me too, because I was going to say, I was like, Andrew just wanted to get one just to fit in.
How you gonna stop them from fucking all those goats at the petting zoo, though?
No, dude. Those are my fucking girls he's taking.
Hey, you better not fuck LeBron or Chris Jericho.
Or Bernie Kosar.
Oh, my God. Wait, so what are those like little wiener lockup things called? Pretty much chastity belts?
I don't know.
But like things.
Me and Andrew,
they're not needed.
I know what he's talking about.
Me and Andrew tried finding those, but they didn't have our right size, so we had to go to Hobby Lobby and look in the thimble section.
and that's where me too, if and Andrew met.
It's cool because they also double for sweaters for worms. That's not even funny.
Wait, what? Okay,
that's dumb. Alrighty, guys. Anything else?
I don't think so.
All right, thank you, everyone, for listening. Be good.
Stay safe.
Laugh at the dark stuff.
Good night.
Hashtag Wildman.
Hashtag pretzel cheese.
Hashtag lizardman.
Oh.
Ooh, I like that.
Hashtag Spider-Man 3 isn't as bad as people think.
It's a fun movie. Same with Suicide Squad. It sucks. It's a piece of shit, but I have fun watching it because Kicking Wings in it for a minute.
Holy shit. That might be the only reason I might go watch it now.
That guy's murder tool is also what I call my penis. The hashtag 2-pound hammer.
The 2-pound hammer. Fuck yeah, dude.
Nice.
Hashtag McRib.
Yeah. Our sex life, the 2-pound hammers.
I love McRibs. Okay, we're done. I love
McRibs so good. Let's say you just bought a house. Bad news is, you're one step closer to becoming your parents. You'll proudly mow the lawn, ask if anybody noticed you mowed the lawn, tell people to stay off the lawn, compare it to your neighbor's lawn, and complain about having to mow the lawn again. Good news is, it's easy to bundle home and auto through Progressive and save on your car insurance, which, of course, will go right into the lawn. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company, affiliates, and other insurers. Discount not available in all states or situations.